Have you been weak at some point and you feel, where is God now? Where is His grace? I'm feeling so weak. I'm feeling so tired. I'm feeling everything is like it's against me. My things are not working and I don't understand what's next. And you keep on asking yourself, where is God now? Where are you, God? Why are you hiding your face? Why are you staying away from me at this time that I need you so much? Now, let me tell you, the Bible promises us one thing. God has promised us His grace. He's told us He is going to give us His grace. And His grace is always there. Now, let's see what the Bible says. Whenever you feel that you're really low and things are not working your way and you feel you can't hold it, you can't handle it, God promises us His grace. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, from verse 9, the Bible says, "And He said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee." My grace is sufficient for thee. Okay? So He says that, don't worry, My grace is sufficient. You see, there are people who think, no, it's like now God has no more grace. It's like I've reached at a point whereby God has no grace left. He's like, he will not give me grace anymore. You know, grace is literally getting what you don't deserve. There are times that you feel, I am the verge of collapsing. I'm at the verge of just a suicide. I'm at the verge of divorcing with my wife. I'm at the verge of losing it in my job. I'm at the verge of losing it with my friends. I've not listened to anyone. I'm really at a situation which I don't know how to control myself. Now, this is the time that God tells you, don't worry, My grace is sufficient. And He continues there and says, "For My strength is made perfect in weakness." Have you ever seen a time that you're really weak and you just need somebody to give you some strength? That's when God says, "Now My strength is perfect in weakness." The only time you can see My strength is during your weakness. The time that you're really, really down. The time that you're feeling everything is just blasted in different ways and you don't know where to start. That's the time that God says, "My grace is really sufficient. I want to show you My strength now. Believe in Me." Let's say you've just lost your job. And you're looking left, right, and center, and you're asking, now, what's going to happen about me? I've lost my job. Maybe my wife has left me. My things are not working. Or somebody has died who was very close to me. And now I am worn out. I am broken. I'm feeling down, and I don't know where to start. That's the time that God tells you, I want to show you My grace. I want to show you My strength. I want to show you how I can change your worst situation to the best situation. There's a time that I used to do some apartment business. And all of a sudden, one day, I used to give out some apartments, which, you know, I just rent and then I give out. And one day I had a trouble with the management of the building, and they told me, no, you can do your business here. And they gave me a letter to leave and stop doing my business there. And I was like, okay, now what am I going to do? This is the only thing that I do. This is how I make my money. How am I going to survive? How are things going to be? And at that time, I cried to God and I told Him, God, see now, these people have just decided one day to wake up and just tell me, no, we don't want you to do your business anymore here. We have terminated your agreement, your contract. Just go and let it be the way it will be. You go die wherever you're going to die. Your problems are not ours. At that time, I cried to God and I told Him, God, You say that Your grace is sufficient. You told us that You show us Your strength in our weak times. And I told God, please, God, show me Your strength. I don't know where to start. I thought of taking these people to the lawyers and rent tribunal and all those kind of things. But something kept on telling me, Keith, vengeance doesn't belong unto you. Leave it. Forget. God is going to give you another way. Another thing to do, another style, another idea. And within no time, I never lacked food. I never lacked something to drink. I never lacked things. I never lacked, survival ways. At the end of the day, within no time, God opened other ways. And I was able to get other different apartments to do business with. And at the end of the day, even they were even much more better than what I had before. They were even 10 times better. And I could look back and say, God, you really show your strength in times of weaknesses. You really show your strength in times when things are really bad. At that point, I thought that was the best. But reached a point when I looked back and I said, how have I been thinking this was the best? I never knew that God was planning something even much more better. And He really actually helped me get out from that, because that was even giving me a very small amount of money. Now, this other one that I've gotten is in a prime place, a good place, and I can make even much more. And I could thank God and tell Him, oh, Jesus Christ, thank you. You showed me your strength in time of my weakness. That's exactly what the Bible is telling us, that He has promised us grace. When you lose your job, when you lose a loved one, when you lose things and things are going in a different way for you, remember that God has told us that His grace is sufficient, and He always shows us His strength in times of weaknesses, okay? And He says, most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. I rather glory in my infirmities. You see, there are people, whenever situations come to them, maybe something has happened, all of a sudden they are crying and saying, there is no God. I can never believe. If God was there, this could not have happened. I don't believe in God. God is a liar. Christianity is a fake. You see, all those people believe if God was there. I've seen so many people on social media, even celebrities, doing this. And they're saying, because this has happened, I don't believe there's God. Let me tell you, God always opens up opportunities in different ways. God will never tempt you. But our own situations, our own ideas, our own problems send us into temptations. And when this happens, we should trust in God and find ourselves and tell ourselves, okay, this has happened. I need to see, why has it happened? And why was God not even concerned when this was happening? It's because there was something maybe wrong which I was doing, and maybe God could not be involved in that. And now you need to turn your mind, change your direction, repent. Repent literally means change your mind or change your direction and do what is right and follow God and believe in Him and tell Him, God, this has happened to me. It's something that I never anticipated. It's something that I know it was beyond my negotiation, it was beyond my will, it was beyond my what I could have wanted. But Lord, you promised us that you'll always raise up us again. When Job lost everything, he lost even his family, he lost everything, his wealth and all those things, he did not wake up and say, oh, there is no God. Even his wife told him, curse this God and die. What did he say? No, God's grace is sufficient. He's going to show me His grace when His time is due. He's going to change my situation when the time is right. And Job did not look at the things that he lost. He did not look at where he was. He focused, he put his mind and his head and his ideas and his thoughts and his trust into God. And told Him, God, please, I know you've known me before the foundations of the world. Before I was woven in my mother's womb, you knew me and all those times and everything that I've done. And you knew even I will have all this kind of wealth. I could have all these good, beautiful children that I've lost. And what happened? When he put his trust in God, God showed him His grace. He showed him strength in times of weaknesses. And he gave him back his wealth, even sevenfold, and his children back, and everything that he had, and he was even seven times more prosperous than the way he was. I'm not saying that we should expect earthly prosperity. Yes, if God gives you, well and good, praise God. But if situations come, and you find yourself in a situation, whether God gives you back your things or He doesn't give you back, remember, in heaven, you have an inheritance. God has promised us in heaven is going to be really good. Remember, if it was about earthly prosperity, then I think God really could have really been a person who really hated Paul, or the other apostles were were so much hated. If about prosperity means God, you know, God loves you. If being prosperous meant God loves you. What about, look at the Apostle Peter, look at the Apostle Paul, look at the other apostles. Stephen, he was stoned. He never even got anything. Paul himself, he was literally poor. He was poor. Most of these apostles, they had nothing. They had only what they are wearing and a couple of other things here and there. So it's not about prosperity which gives you salvation or which shows you that God is interested with you. It's about your relationship with Him. So the more you have a better relationship with God, the better you are, all right? So I think that one you've been able to understand is a promise of the promise of grace that God has promised us as His children. And this one has been promised to His children. And how can you become a child of God? There's only one way you can become a child of God, and that is through believing the gospel. The gospel is found in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. And it says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which you received and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures." The Apostle Paul lays it so clear for us. He tells us it's all about how Christ died for our sins, how he shed his blood on the cross. If you believe in that blood that he shed, in Romans 3:25, it says, "In whom God has set forth to be a propitiation." A propitiation. Through faith in his blood. When you have faith in the blood of Jesus Christ, he becomes your propitiation, your substitute. He substitutes the death that you were to get. And he tells you, no. Now you're believed in the finished work. Just, you are supposed to die. You're supposed to do all those things. You're supposed to... But God has put forth Jesus, God the Father has put forth God the Son, who is Jesus Christ, as a propitiation for our sins through faith in the blood that he shed on the cross. When you believe that, you're saved. So thank you very much. I'll be speaking about the promise of provision next time. And I hope it will be a blessing unto you. Thank you for having listened to this. Let's look forward and let's be blessed together, all right?